Well, the channel has hit 50,000 subscribers, which is awesome. Hooray for us. Thank you very much. So this channel also was featured as 13th in machine learning YouTube channels by KD Nuggets, which is also quite awesome. So on to 100,000. You can certainly help me do that. Click that subscribe button, click the like button. Now, I don't know, milestone videos can be quite boring, so I don't want to bore you necessarily with a lot of, I don't know, hooray for the channel sort of stuff. What I'm going to do instead is talk to you about kind of how you can move forward in social media for a coding technical channel, kind of like what I have here, where I took it, how you get to kind of, I'm going to talk about really five levels. Now there's a billion people talking about YouTube and how to succeed at YouTube. So everybody really, and well, their dog. So to make this at least halfway useful, I think it's good because I'm not a gigantic YouTuber. I've got 50K people, but that's not trivial to get to by any stretch. So I'm going to talk to you really about some steps that you would take if you're interested in really getting your code, your projects out there, and even how you might think about a project. So let's go ahead. I'll start with showing you just how I record these videos, do the quote-unquote studio tour, and then I'll just talk about what I consider to be the five stages of growth for this. And we'll also talk about some of the cardinal sins, I think, of YouTube. I broke them all. I've committed them all. So I'll show you, and you can learn from my many, many mistakes. And I'm probably making even more mistakes on this particular video, but this is the growth. This is how you learn and move forward. So this is probably close to the angle that you see most of my videos recorded from. These are all shot from my home office, which is a spare bedroom. This is very much a family space, just to show you the area. Over here is where my wife has been teaching virtual school during the COVID crisis. She's got quite the setup with a green screen. You can see her here as she's getting ready to teach a class. Other members of the family are also allowed to be in here. That's Hickory. You've heard him occasionally snore bomb a video, but mostly I keep his audio effects out of it. He's a very sweet English bulldog. Going around to here, this is how I shoot the videos. The computer is sitting, the workstation with the rainbow LED going on, that is my primary workstation. It dual boots between Windows and Linux. It's a pretty advanced computer. I have entire videos on it. NVIDIA was kind enough to give me the A6000 that is what it runs on. I have there a Surface laptop. The primary thing that it does is it runs my camera, and you can see it there. My camera is not crazy advanced. It's a Canon M50 mirrorless camera. I've got a couple of lenses for it. I could potentially get a better lens that is closer to me, but I have it USB connected to the laptop so that I can control it remotely. Mostly, I want to get autofocus set up on me well so that it's not constantly bouncing in and out of autofocus if I happen to move around a bit. And then, of course, Hickory has his spot that he can sleep in here when I'm working on things. And you can see some of his toys. He's a good boy. Snores very loudly. That's the main challenge with keeping him around when a video is shot. The window is a bit of a challenge. You can see that I have it blocked out. Otherwise, I am just crazy exposed, like you see in this video. Or sometimes the lighting would even literally change as the sun went in front of and behind clouds. So this is basically the home office, where I record my videos and where I run most of the code as I get things working on that computer back there. So these are what I really consider the stages of growth, at least that I went through for this YouTube channel. First, I would say choose a project. Find something that really, really interests you. And this is great for any sort of a learning process. We'll talk about what to pick for the project in a moment, but something that interests you. Now, I've been doing projects all my life. I started programming probably back in like fourth grade and always created something. Now, if you just create something and you don't ever do anything with it, it's just code rotting on a disk somewhere and nobody will ever see it. You'll probably lose it. I can't find half the code that I produced back when I was an undergrad. And sometimes I want to go back and look at it. Now, GitHub exists now. I would say the next step is getting your code on GitHub. Even if it's just mainly you that's going to look at it, but it gets you to the point that you're putting something on GitHub and you're really getting it into a state that you're not embarrassed of other people to look at it. And that sounds harsh, but don't worry. There is a lot of code at all levels on GitHub. So don't let that deter you, but try to put your best face on the code that you're going to put it there. Now, from GitHub, where I would suggest is do a Medium article, do some sort of a posting to LinkedIn, LinkedIn and Medium or Twitter. Those are really the big three that I use once I put something together that's kind of neat on GitHub. And very much, YouTube has become the pinnacle of what I do on social media. But this is really just me throwing things at the wall and seeing what sticks. For some reason, of all the paths that I blazed, people seem to care most about the YouTube videos. Twitter, not as much, but lately, I'm almost to 10K followers on Twitter. So Twitter, by virtue of my YouTube channel, has started to grow. So as much as you can sort of double dip on these and post what you write something on GitHub, do a video about it, post that on LinkedIn, post it on Twitter, basically just see what you get and let the likes sort of guide you. You'll hear a lot about the YouTube algorithm. I don't really care about the YouTube algorithm. I probably lost all credibility there as a YouTube promoter, and maybe that's why I have 50,000 subscribers instead of 500K. But I do what I'm interested in, and I let basically the YouTube algorithm find me a following that fits that. I'm not going to chase the YouTube algorithm like a squirrel and try to basically feed it to get more and more subscribers. This is also really a hobby for me. Full time, I work as an executive in a large insurance company in data science, solving hard technology problems. So this is very much a hobby for me. This is something that's fun that I do. The next thing to do, and I would recommend this, is do the faceless video. Getting your face on YouTube it adds a lot of extra dimensions. Suddenly you're a video engineer and an audio engineer and all these additional things. And it's just an endless rabbit hole. You're learning about lenses on cameras and aperture and lighting and all that kind of stuff. Don't get overwhelmed by that. Honestly, my face is the least important part of these videos. Do you agree? Let me know in the comments. Maybe I'm not necessarily thinking of that the right way. But basically, just hook up use a screencasting software. There's plenty of them out there Screencast-O-Matic is one that I started with, then graduated into Camtasia, and now I even dabble in Adobe Premiere Pro. But just walk people through it. Show them the code. Show them the output from it. Use a Jupyter notebook if you're doing Python, that kind of thing. So, but get great audio. We'll talk about that in a moment. The YouTuber audience will forgive you for bad lighting, for not being at the right point in the camera, not making eye contact with the audience, all these kind of bad things. They will forgive you for that. They won't forgive you for audio. I get more criticism, and I mean criticism in a good way. I don't mind in the least, on audio. When I screw up audio, I hear about it. So that's, we'll talk about that one in a minute. Then if you want to start adding video, and I mean video coming from a camera, not video captured from your screen, that's a whole nother realm, and it gets you into the world of maybe using things more than just a cell phone camera, but the cell phone camera is a great thing to get started. The whole studio tour that I gave you just earlier was filmed on this. So notice the audio, notice the video. The smaller cameras, like the one that I'm using right now that's mounted on my computer, it just doesn't have the aperture of something like the Canon that I use. So it's very unforgiving of lighting. You have to add the light to, there's just not as much that I can do there. I actually don't use lights on any of my videos. This room has the window that I showed you, and usually it's just controlling that window's light so that I don't look like I'm on fire with overexposure. Then stage five, which I'm starting to get to more and more, which is just, I don't know, using the green screen like you can probably see behind me, bringing in animations. I mean, good grief. Some of the bringing in animations, doing that sort of thing. Some of the channels out there are amazing actually at this. And then beyond, I don't know what stage 6, 7, 8, and 9 look like. I'm sure I'll be much better at this by the time I hit 100K, probably by the time I hit 75K. Who knows? Even by 50,001, you can be that person. Click the subscribe button. So let's talk about choosing a project, because this is important. So choosing a project, finance and markets are always fun, but I mean, the thing you have to realize, if you're writing the neural network to predict the stock market, the first question I'm going to ask you is, if you've cracked the stock market with your neural network, why are you recording YouTube videos? Because you're going to be too busy on your yacht, seriously. Cool video and audio effects, these are also awesome. I've used the GANs for this. Just find something that interests you, that you're interested in doing videos about. Your job, that's what got me going. Okay, yeah, my primary job is I work for a large life insurance company. But I started teaching classes for Washington University as an adjunct. And due to my travel schedule one semester, literally I could not be there to teach the class. So I started recording these videos and putting them up onto YouTube. I don't think I even thought much about subscribers at that point, or even knew how many I had, and just started putting those videos out. And all of a sudden I start getting more views than my students. So if you're in academia, you've got a great avenue to because you're creating this kind of content all the time. And what your students are asking you, you may not want to put your whole course on YouTube. That's a bit insane. It's taken a lot of time, but that is what got me started. And then I create videos related to that. Analyzing social media, I don't know, I thought that might be interesting. This one I'll talk about, apply a larger project. So look at other projects out there on YouTube. Look at my, Jeff Heaton's, GitHub repositories. Look at some of my more popular projects. And maybe you want to do something related to that. Because if you do something related to one of my projects, you give me a shout out on Twitter or something saying, hey, look at this awesome video I did related to some of your stuff. I'm going to ping that back, and you're going to get some traffic from me as a result. In fact, if you're particularly interested in that one, reach out to me. I would be glad to give you an idea for something related to what I've done that you could build on, because then that helps take things that I've started and go further with them, and I've got more ideas than I have time to record. Code from a recent paper, just look at the 2-minute papers that is another popular YouTube, massively popular YouTube channel, and find out what code is related to one of those brand new papers that just came out, and do a video showing how to actually get the code running and doing something like that. Believe me, when StyleGAN came out, if you would have just got a video out there within even the first month, showing how to actually apply some of that code out there in interesting ways, you'll get views. And then cheerlead a Medium or a GitHub repository. So if there's a repo out there, now some YouTuber, one very famous YouTuber, got into a lot of trouble with this, but give proper credit. It's okay to be a cheerleader and say, hey, look at these neat things that this other person did. If you're modifying their code, clone the repository so that it links back. Don't copy their repo and rebrand it as your own. That's just crummy, because they put a lot of work into it. It's great to cheerlead other code, and I do that myself, because there are people that are a lot more advanced than like NVIDIA. I frequently show their code, like StyleGAN 2 and other things. So let's talk about some of the major sins of YouTube, just to kind of close this out. And these are in order. This is what annoys people the most, down to the ones that don't seem to annoy people as much. Use headphones. Always listen to your videos on headphones, high quality ones, because they'll give you the best sound back. And if you put your headphones on and you only hear one side, you've messed up. Some lavalier mics will literally send just one channel or the other. That's how I always messed that one up. Low quality audio. This is bad. So what I am using for this is a Blue Yeti. This is a great microphone. I'm probably freaking it out now, so that's why the audio probably sounds weird. Video speed and pauses. I mean, look at some of the comments on this video that I made ages ago. Jump cut those pauses, cut them out, and go through them. And background music. I don't know. Some people like this, some people are effective with it. I have never done it, and I consider it mostly a distraction. Maybe transitional music if I wanted to get a little more creative. Lighting can be good if you're getting into the video. There's plenty of videos out there talking about how to do lighting. So here you can see the camera is auto-focusing, and as I bop around or move a little bit, it'll change the focus. And just as I'm talking, this is a common problem. I don't think it's one of the most egregious problems that you can have, but it's a little bit of a distraction. Basically, just by using that screen that I have sitting right there, I am able to turn off the autofocus. Once I kind of nail it like I like it, then I turn it off. And I do that just on the big camera where it's focused on just me. This camera it's just a Logitech camera that I have mounted on top of my monitor. And I let it autofocus as it needs, because really I use it when the screen is the focus of what I'm doing, not me. I'm the least important part of this. It's the code and my voice leading you through it. Thank you for watching this video. On to 100,000, and you can help. Click the subscribe button, click the like button, and thank you for watching my videos. I hope they are useful to you, and I'm always interested in hearing your comments, both positive and negative. Let me know what you're interested in seeing further from this channel. Thank you so much.